you very much.
Yeah, that were the questions. Okay, then we continue with the giants. The next universal symbol we find all over the world in fairy tales and in myths, as well as in many religious writings, such as the Bible or the Indian Mahabharata, but also in the Eddas and the Babylonian writings, for example. And in almost all these cases, these giants are engaged in a battle, either against gods or among themselves, or against humans. And in certain cases, this concerns a historical battle that has actually taken place. But in all other cases, it is a metaphor to make it clear that a certain characteristic prevails over another, so that one quality becomes dominant over another. And just one more remark on why we see so much battle and struggle in symbolism, and actually that is one more of such a key, a universal key, is because the origin of the symbolism can be traced back to a time when it simply suited best the mentality of humanity. Because there was a time when battle among nations was much more common, and therefore the best metaphor to signify the prevailing of one aspect, the good, so to say, over another, over evil. So the same applies to giants. We encounter good and bad giants in scriptures. And also here, the symbolism can be applied to several levels, as pointed out before the break. For the battle of giants can relate to cosmic processes, to events taking place on our earth, and ultimately to ourselves, so aspects within ourselves that the giant represents. And actually this is a example when you talk about 7x7, you see here already three layers of the same symbolism. So if we then start at the beginning, at the cosmic level, the coming into being of the cosmos, we see the first giant Ymir showing up in the Eddas. And Ymir represents the material side of the universe, but not yet the manifested universe as we can physically perceive it, but cosmic primordial substance, so to speak, one of the two polarities of spirit and matter that emerge at the start of the reappearance of a universe. And Ymir, as in all battle stories, is defeated by the gods, and from his different body parts, the various parts of the cosmos and the earth are made. So, for example, his skull becomes the sky, his sweat the oceans, and his bones and teeth become the mountains. But the symbolic message here is that from this primordial substance, ever further descending into the different realms or planes of consciousness, all the different worlds are eventually formed. But this formation process does not happen automatically. It requires an underlying formative force or consciousness that works with or through that material side. And that's where we find the first giants, the Titans in Greek mythology. The Titans, again, important in their function of cosmocratores, because there are many types of Titans, but in this case, in their function of cosmocratores, and that means literally builders of worlds. And those titans are divine forces, also called Gyani Buddhas, or architects, who by using this primordial substance, or cooperating with it, better said, build the universe. And the combination of the two types of giants we also find in the celestial war between the giants and the gods of the Hindu Puranas, the battle between the Devas and the Asuras, who in their turn respectively symbolize the spirit and matter side, and of which the secret doctrine hints that the first of these wars takes place even before the solar system has come into existence, so really on this cosmical level. But there's a second battle taking place between these two, the Devas and the Asuras, let's say mirroring the first one on a lower plane, as above, so below. And that battle is within the solar system, when it is already manifested. And now we descend to the planetary level, a battle taking place in the inner regions of the solar system, all the way reaching to humanity on Earth. And also this battle can be found by the Greeks, symbolized by the war of the Titans and the gods on the Olympus, we all probably have heard about, as the Titans rebelling against the gods. And one of the Titans in this category we know as Prometheus, who gets in conflict with Zeus because he stole the fire from heaven to give to humanity. And this story, the symbolism of this rebellion, represents humanity's stage of development when our thinking faculty became active, awakened, so to speak, or stimulated by these Titans, these more advanced beings of the quality of the inner sun. And remember then the painting of Machel again. In Sanskrit, these beings are called Manasaputras, who descended to Earth, to the Earth's realm, to help humanity activating their thinking mind. And I'm now outlining in just a few sentences an event about which much more could be said. But what is important for now is that it is this descent into a lower plane of consciousness to which the symbolism of rebellion against the gods refers. Because the quality of this lower realm is in conflict, you might say, with the spiritual quality of those Titans. The exact same symbolism you find also in the Bible with the fallen angels and Lucifer, the light bringer, of which the symbolic meaning over time has entirely degenerated to a symbol of evil, just because the inner meaning of this actually very compassionate event of helping humanity has been lost completely. Finally, there's another war of giants, and then we descend again a little further to our physical Earth, because this war takes place within humanity itself. And this is the historical battle that I mentioned earlier that literally took place at the end of a phase in our own history in which we were at the top of our material development and therefore in an all-time low of our spiritual development, a time of spiritual awareness, as Plato calls it, in which the attraction to matter was strongest, a phase when we were mentally and morally, let's say, undeveloped, but on the other hand, physically very big and strong. And it is this giant we encounter in all the fairy tales and legends, big, clumsy, not too clever, or actually not clever at all, but very strong. So a reference to our former selves in the Atlantic phase, as it is called, following the time period in which our faculty of thinking became active, that I mentioned relating to Prometheus. And also this fight on Earth, you see a duality in which we can distinguish two types of giants. First of all, the laggards, the Atlanteans I just described, called the Daityas in Indian mythology, and at the other hand, forerunners, the Devatas, meaning semi-divine, who stand for the teachers of humanity, the initiates and adepts who are, so to speak, representatives of that category of titans to which Prometheus belongs, one step lower, you might say, in the hierarchy of Buddhas or helpers of humanity. And in the Hindu epic, the Mahabharata, that Hindu epic, in fact, is all about this battle between the giants of the Atlantic phase and the progenitors of humanity of our current phase. A battle that took place hundreds of thousands of years ago, partly around the Nile Delta, as is said. And maybe that sounds all a bit fantasy-like and far away, but nevertheless we can find traces of it today. Very concrete examples, actually, in the form of megalithic monuments on various places in the world. Statues that probably look familiar, but of which you might have a better understanding now how and where to place them in our own history. And these are on the one hand the statues of Easter Island, And on the other, the gigantic Bamiyan Buddhas in Afghanistan that were unfortunately destroyed by the Taliban in 2001. And I think it is clear to which type both belong. On the left, the somewhat rough statues with primitive features of the Atlanteans on the eastern island, on average 4.5 meters, and the largest 21 meters. And on the right, the forerunners, the human Buddhas, also called the sons of God, of which each developmental phase of humanity has its specific Buddha. And what you see here is two of those Buddhas depicted. And they are really gigantic. I hope you can see it, but there is a human walking near the feet of one of those statues, and one is 38 and the other is 55 meters high. But both monuments, Theosophy states, are actually built at the end of the Atlantic phase. So to sum all up, when reading about battling giants, whether titans, daityas or asuras, it is always important to look at the context to understand at what scale or what event it refers to. But in general, you can say that whatever level the battle takes place, it is always one between spirit and matter, between higher and lower, developed consciousness, and translated to human level, a battle between good and evil, or in other words, selfish and unselfish. And coming back to the hero, it is exactly this latter what the hero's fight with the giant stands for, the inner fight between his selfish and unselfish impulses, the fight between the Atlantean and the Titan within us, so to speak, whereby self-conquest thus means overcoming our own Atlantean habits of materialistic selfishness that actually belongs to our past. And as long as the hero has not yet conquered these habits, he prevents himself from advancing on that inner path. Then next, the dwarves, as mentioned, just like the giants, seen from our perspective. But in the case of dwarves, that purely concerns development of consciousness, because dwarves symbolize very primitive elements way behind on us at the very beginning of their evolutionary development. And that is also the reason why you usually don't encounter them fighting in myths and fairy tales, because they are yet fully unself-conscious, not knowing good and evil, right or wrong, and therefore not yet fighting. Dwarves are actually part of a whole group of fairy tale characters you come across as elves, trolls, fairies, goblins, and so on, who collectively are also called nature spirits. And that group as a whole symbolizes the forces of nature that are being shaped by those elemental building blocks, even more primitive than the mineral kingdom. And in Theosophy, these beings are called elementals. And by elementals you can think of forces like electricity and magnetism, but also phenomena like heat, for example. Actually all processes in which forces are involved. So when we start a car, when we are cooking our dinner, or simply lift our arm, we make use of these elementals. The same goes for our thinking process, because also thoughts are elementals. Since we make use of them, we often find dwarves in a supporting role as a positive force, but it is not necessarily always the case, because dwarves too have this dual nature of good and bad. And just think, for instance, of the fire we can positively use for preparing our dinner, but which in case we lose control over it can result in burning our whole house down. And electricity is pretty much indispensable in our lives, but can also be deadly in certain cases. And just the same holds for thoughts, because we have positive and negative thoughts. So in principle, they are unself-conscious neutral forces, but depending on the situation and how we use them, they can be positive or negative towards us. So friendly or unfriendly dwarves, so to speak. As I said, dwarves are part of an entire group of nature spirits, and within that group they represent a specific characteristic. Because you can divide that group, in fact, into four categories of the elements: fire, air, water and earth, which in which, according to the classification of Paracelsus, among others, the salamanders represent the element fire, the sylphs the element air, the undines, the water nymphs, the element water, and the gnomes the element earth. And it is this last category of the gnomes to which the dwarves can be considered, and in which you can also clearly see this characteristic of that earth element in the various fairy tales and myths. Dwarves, for example, searching for earthly treasures underground, like the seven dwarves of Snow White, who are digging for jewels in the mines during the day, or the dwarves preserving underground treasures, like the goblins in Harry Potter, who guard the money and treasures in the bank of Gringotts underground. If we consider ourselves again, what the symbolism of dwarves means to us, it is interesting to look again at the origin of the word gnome, which is gnome in Greek, meaning mind or intelligence. And if you combine this with the element earth, you see the challenge that the hero faces. For how does he direct his mind and apply his intelligence? Is it focused on acquiring earthly possessions or instead spiritual richness? In other words, concerning the hero, is he capable of controlling the dwarves or his earthly thought elementals? And a good example where this is not the case is the story which we all know as the Sorcerer's Apprentice, who, because of laziness, enchants a broom to make it do the work for him, but which then gets completely out of control because he cannot control the broomstick, his elementals, because he lacks mastery over it. And this emphasizes the importance of a pure, unselfish motive that the hero must have, so that once he is confronted with his own earthly elementals, he can master and thus control them. Before we go to the break, let's have a look again to Machel's painting to see if we can see some elements of the giants and the dwarves. And one aspect of the battle between the gods and the giants, the rebelling titans, takes place in the area that I marked red. It's a bit hard to see, but in the background you see a group of yellow figures of that spiritual quality or Buddhic splendor of the inner sun. And in the middle, between the hero and this group, you see a figure returning that you may consider as the titan Prometheus, turning to go down again, given by compassion to help humanity coming after him. Only with this remark that he represents our own inner Prometheus, because in fact this middle figure is the hero, further advanced on the path, when he has activated this Buddhic quality within himself, symbolized by those rays of light that come from the inner heart that he has become one with, radiating to all those behind who are following the path. And if we have a look at the symbolism of the dwarf, the elemental of the earthly characteristic, we see below right a figure climbing the rocks, but to whom the path remains closed, since he is stopped by the guardians, because he has a money bag hung at his belt, or in other words, he has not yet succeeded in having the dwarves to obey him, in mastering his thoughts of material wealth, because he is still too much influenced by them. We'll have a break now again of 3 minutes, so see you after the break. Welcome back, Jenny. Are there questions?
Yes, there is a question. But first, I'm very curious about the elementals and what you wanted to tell us more about that.
About the key 7x7. I promised it, so I have to explain it. Well, those elementals, those really primitive beings, I give the examples of the elements, fire, air, water and earth. And we have cosmic planes that also are given those elements of the plane of fire, the plane of air, water and earth is our physical plane. But I also mentioned thoughts, and thoughts is just one aspect of it. You can say the earth aspect is the mind, the thinking aspect, so thoughts is one of the seven. But within thoughts, we again have the water aspect, the air, the fire. So we have emotional thoughts, we have earthly thoughts that are the gnomes, the dwarves I talked about. We have spiritual thoughts, so more fiery-like thoughts. So that is the example I had in mind when the question came, 7x7, that you can see that it's life within life, conscious within consciousness, and many keys that you can turn around many times. Yeah.
Nice, thank you.
Okay, yeah.
And there's another question. Are some dwarves or gnomes more dangerous than others for us humans?
Yeah, at least that is what you read in the theosophical literature. But there are not really actual examples given. But as said, I give an overview in this lecture, and I know I talk about many aspects, but still it's just the tip of the iceberg, because for example in the Eddas there are 168 dwarves, individual dwarves with each an own name, representing all their own characteristic. And you have white dwarves, you have black dwarves, so there you encounter also the duality, the both types of dwarves. Yeah, and I gave the example of fire as an elemental that can be really useful to us as a positive dwarf, so to speak, but also really negative in case you burn your hand or But it's important to emphasize that in itself it is not good or evil, the elemental. That is really important, but it is for us, how we use it, and to us it can be positive or negative. That's an important remark to make, yeah.
Nice. There's one more question, that is, why are those who give us the mind considered to have committed a sin? So Prometheus and so on. Why were the gods angry about that?
Yeah, that is the rebellion. And I had to search for it to understand it. But the point is, I try to explain, but it's hard to explain. So it's the same as you have the Hades, the underworld, in the Greek mythology. And if we would go into the underworld, it would be a sin, so to speak, because we are on the level of this plane. And if we go to the underworld, it's against the level of being that we are in now. So you have the divine beings who belong to the divine plane, but the sin is that they leave that plane, because that is against their inner nature. But it's not a sin, it's a beautiful act of compassion, because they leave their own level of consciousness in order to help humanity awaken the mind. And unfortunately, the idea of sin has become the main idea in the Christian Bible, with Lucifer, the light bringer, as the devil, and the snake as an evil doer. While in fact they represent the higher beings helping us enlightening our mind. Yeah, I hope it's clear now.
Yeah. Yes.
Otherwise, we will hurt.
Yes, that was it.
Yeah. Okay, then we continue with the last part, the snakes and the dragons, which I mentioned before. That can